Thank you. Welcome to the October 5th, 2016 meeting of the Board of Selectmen, Board of Health at the Town Municipal Offices here on Conway Street. First order of the business, we are without any staff. So the first thing I was hoping to do was to make sure that we don't have any issues with communication and no violations and be transparent and everything. I was hoping that we could meet weekly.
That'd be great.
Would that be okay?
That'd be great.
So I was hoping to look at our calendars for the month, and I was next week. Here I am, the one saying, could we meet at 6:45 next week?
Yeah, we had. I had to meet for that first night of the administrator search committee.
Okay. So do you want to? Then
that'd be great. 6:45, okay. I think is fine. I would imagine.
Or seven.
I was kidding. No, that time's all right. But what did you say you have to go for a town administrator search committee?
Yes.
Oh. When is that?
That's.
Oh, you can't show up. He's on it.
So I can't show up.
No.
You can't be. Oh, right.
No, because then it's a quorum.
I think it's going to be an executive session.
Yeah, it's the reason why it can't be more than one member is because then it is okay. Become has to be open meeting. So this
are
is
those
Wendy.
Applications in the town hall.
Wendy has them. I have not seen them. I don't know who they are. And
is she going to be here tomorrow?
No, she won't be here till Tuesday.
Oh. All right.
You can call her.
Okay.
It's okay to call.
Okay.
Okay. So is 6:45 okay for?
Yeah, I just want to put that in.
Okay.
Yep. So that's the 12th.
Yes, 6:45 on the 12th. We have a regular meeting on the 19th.
Correct.
And then could we do 6:30 on the 26th?
Yep.
Or is that
yep.
One of your meetings?
Nope, that's fine. I think
okay.
I should be okay.
All right. So let's try that.
Yeah. Do you want to do anything else any further than that? Or?
Well, let's set up that initially.
Okay.
And then I'll see how it goes. I ended up spending, it was roughly about 4 hours today. So
okay.
I'm coming in every day, but honestly, I don't know how often I can do,
right.
You know, four
that
to
month,
8 hours.
That amount of time.
Yeah. I mean,
the first.
I'm sorry. So the 19th was that regular time? 6:30?
Yes. The only
yep.
The only time is next.
Yep.
I have my granddaughter
6:45.
And a dog on next Wednesday because my other granddaughter chipped her teeth. Victoria has to take her in, so to the dentist and the orthodontist. So.
Just the first week of November, I'll be away at a school committee conference, but at the Cape. But other than that,
So
I'll be around. Like I could do Monday or Tuesday of that week, but
and that's what we'll do.
Yeah.
Okay. And then what I'll do is, if it looks like we have too much stuff
mm-hmm.
building up that can't wait a week, then and I'll have Pat circulate stuff so it's
mm-hmm.
not, like I said, no deliberation, no violations
right.
or anything. But if it can't be, if it anything comes up, we'll have
know.
A 48-hour meeting
yeah.
kind of thing.
It's fine, whatever it takes.
At least we'll meet weekly.
Okay.
Okay. So that's sorted out. Approved minutes. Do we have?
I have an issue. There's one on the 21st.
Okay.
On the same thing, on the snow removal service award. I didn't make the motion. Trevor did.
Oh,
yeah, that, I thought that.
Yeah,
I was looking
at
that.
Okay.
I thought that too.
Let me just move. As amended.
Yep.
Was there anything else that you found?
No, I was good with that one.
Okay.
And then the 27th?
I didn't read the 27th either.
That's okay. We have a second. I just want to make sure that you felt comfortable with all this.
Yeah, that's what I know.
Okay. It seems pretty accurate, but I wasn't sure.
I'm good with that.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, I'll take a motion to approve them.
I make a motion to approve the minutes of the Select Board for September 21st, 2016, and September 27th, 2016.
As they're amended.
As amended.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll second the motion.
Okay, if there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'm going to make a motion to sign the payroll warrants as well?
Yep.
Okay.
Second that?
Second.
Sorry. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. You know, we never used to vote on that, but people are starting to do that. So
yeah,
I think we just have to...
Sure. Did you guys already sign them?
I have not.
Okay. No, I haven't either. So I haven't looked at them. Julie, do you want to come up and tell us about new stuff?
Playground Part 2?
Yes.
Yes.
Sure. So we are building one more piece of play equipment for the Deerfield Elementary School playground. Last year, a year ago, we had a huge effort and had, I don't know, 150 people showing up, and we built this gorgeous big playground. We wanted to add one more piece of equipment on the other side of the school because the fifth and sixth grade classes, recess is on the other side of the school, and there's not a lot out there in terms of equipment to add. So we're adding it's called a play web. It's a sort of a climbing structure that we'll be putting in. The build date, we're doing another community build. The build date will be October 22nd. We're actually scheduling the 22nd and the 23rd. We have hopes that we can finish in one day, but if not, we will do Sunday as well. So that's 2 weeks from this Saturday. We'll need about 15 volunteers each day. There's online registration set up, and it's been sent out through the PTA. We have several volunteers already, so I don't have any qualms that we'll have sufficient people to come build. I've talked to Kevin Scarborough. There's Home Depot is donating all the cement, so the Great. Town is going to drive up and pick that up for us.
Oh, nice.
Which is nice.
Yeah.
And yeah, I don't know. That's the point.
How wonderful.
Last time we had a mixer. Have we got?
We do, yeah, and Home Depot doesn't have a mixer, so I'm still working on that.
Yeah.
Looking for, we may just rent one if we
right.
can't get one donated, but
yeah.
yeah, that would help a lot.
Absolutely. Great.
Is that apparatus going to be on the west side of the school building,
yeah.
where the gym is?
Yes.
Yes,
okay.
It's going to be on the west side.
I know I've said it before, and I'm not trying to be a, what do you call that, a scaredy cat, but it, you know, about a month ago, I made a comment here because I was up at the school roof doing, you know, inspections, and I just happened to be there when the train went by, and I know that the train goes by that school three times while school's in session, and that week there was a train derailment in Indiana and 30 kids got hurt. No one died, but when the train slid off, it just wiped out all these kids, and that swing set and stuff is about 35 feet from the train tracks, and I was just suggesting that all that apparatus be moved further away from the tracks in case a train ever did come off. I know it might not ever, but on the other hand, if it did, that's all.
Any thoughts on where we're citing that?
Our original plan was to put it, you know, where the Gaga Ball court and the swing sets are, there's a
yep.
spot in between those two, right against that fence there on the
mm-hmm.
side next to the train track, and was to put it in between there. The rationale behind that is that the kids play sports like
soccer.
Football and soccer and stuff on that field, and that keeps the field open for the kids to play.
They do a lot of practice.
Yeah,
baseball
yeah.
and stuff there too.
So we can put it, we want it on that side of the school because that's where the fifth, sixth grade plays
right.
and we want something for them to have. We could move it over closer to the school, kind of up, you know, where the basketball court, where people park there, kind of in that corner, or down, you know, like if you go straight down the loop.
All the way down.
Down the other end of that field.
Do you think you could try to sort that out?
Yeah, I'm happy to look at it.
Janine said she was open to somebody coming by and walking through with her and talking about that if the select board wants input on the location of the piece of equipment.
That'd be great. I'm thinking about, you know, as Kip talked about, when we put in new stuff, I was just thinking, I know the swings are there, the Gaga ball court is there, and that's not an easy move. But any new stuff we put in, we might want to have it a little bit further away. But, yeah, I could get over and talk and
just see.
Just see
what we can do.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Okay.
And if you have questions, maybe we can figure out something.
Yep.
You know.
Okay.
Because it is a really a concern, you know.
It's a low probability, but if it does, it's...
Then it would be,
I mean, maybe we can just sort of... The problem is the schedules are not always the same. So even if you were aware of the schedules of the...
Of the train.
Trains, so you could work your recesses around non-train time. It doesn't mean that the trains are going to be on time or that they don't change the schedule or add additional runs or whatever. I mean, there's there's no communication. I mean, we have a hard time with the railroad communication for emergency situations anyway. So I cannot imagine that they would be very communicative with us trying to set up some kind of avoidance kind of issues, you know. So it would not be reliable no matter what. So I think if we can do some kind of, you know, just being aware of it, it would be so much nicer than...
I'm supposed to walk through tomorrow with Kevin Scarborough.
Oh, what time?
About 11.
Okay. All right.
If you can make that, we can do it, because we were going to do the dig safe. He was going to work the dig safe for us.
Oh, great. Perfect.
So we need to know where we're digging in order to do that.
Yeah. Great.
Jeff, did you have something?
Yeah, my first question has been answered, because I have heard Kip before express concern about location. So that's good to hear.
Yes.
As far as being away from there. And the second one is the funding of the new equipment, as far as where that is coming from.
So when the town voted to support the whole playground project, they voted $300,000.
Okay.
We had $20,000
left
in that account. This piece is about it's $15,000 and like $29 or something like that. We actually intend to also, the other thing we proposed when we proposed the playground was to have more shade. And so we want to put a shade structure on the side where we did the big playground build. Also, we're thinking that's going to be around $6,000, but we want to get like more bids and everything. So that's not actually part of this effort.
Okay. So the bleed's still a little left in. And
yeah. So this actually, it's that structure where we're actually adding four benches to the to the playground side.
Great.
So that's part of this. And that's included in that $15,000.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Thank you, Julie, for taking the time. And
all your effort on that whole project, too.
It's wonderful. And it's really nice. I know the kids really enjoy it, from what I hear.
It's a fun playground.
It sure is.
They're having a good time. Yep. All right. Thanks.
Thanks, Julie.
Next item on the agenda is the cable franchise, but I guess he didn't show up. So we're just going to move on.
Okay.
Next item, Zach, thanks for coming. We have the new ambulance information. I do have that here.
Okay.
So, Zach, do you want to just go over it for everybody that was not at the... meeting?
Sure. At the last Board of Oversight meeting, which was a couple weeks ago now, the subgroup that was tasked with speccing out a replacement ambulance made their final presentation. They reviewed all the manufacturers out there, both upfitters and chassis and all that, put a pretty comprehensive presentation together and came up with a recommendation based around patient and crew member safety. So with all that put together and finally specced out, this is the contract to purchase that ambulance as approved by the Board of Oversight at the last meeting. So based on the presentation, the Board of Oversight agreed that this was the way to go and liked what they saw. So this is the contract for that. And also before you is the cooperative purchasing agreement with the government entity, the Houston-Galveston Area Council. So they have gone out to bid for various ambulance manufacturers, just as any other municipal public group buy-in.
Yeah.
And this was the most reasonable, cheapest municipal bid spec for this model ambulance.
And so I get that you use that bid spec and that system, but it's legal for us as Massachusetts to
yes.
To
so this is
that.
Open okay. to any other municipality or nonprofit anywhere in the country.
Oh, nice.
So and all the language is in there inside the agreement.
Okay. Then I guess I need a motion for us to sign this as per agreed the other night.
I make a motion to sign the purchase agreement for the new ambulance for South County EMS.
I'll second the motion.
Okay. Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none?
Is this going out to bid?
Oh, no. This is already done. This
has
already
been accepted.
It's already been accepted. The dollar amount, the final dollar amount is $269,982. This is, I think we appropriated $285.
We did. We appropriated $285 for fiscal year, what are we in now, 17?
17.
So that money is sitting there for this purchase, and they were able to find it for cheaper.
Yep.
It's last year's.
Our oldest one in the fleet, so the 2001.
Which is Whately's?
Yep. Yes, it was originally Whately's, yep.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. So I will sign. So I will sign this, but I think it needs a notary, doesn't it? Or I'll sign this and give this to Pat. And if there's any issues,
yep.
We'll get
Sounds
back.
Sounds great.
Okay. I'm sorry. I don't have a more definitive. Explanation. I'll let Pat sort this out tomorrow. And right here.
Yep.
Do you want me to give this to Pat, or do you want to take it and then run it around?
I think
tomorrow?
He was gonna. Right? Because
you wanted
a guy.
To take it.
Okay. Yeah. I'll hold on to the.
No, the, I know you're nervous.
We're trying to get this chassis, get our name on a chassis, and the representative is going to be in the area tomorrow morning. And he said, if you can get
well,
it to me,
let me date
then,
it.
Yeah.
And if you need it notarized, I can. I'm in here till 9:30 in town. Then I'll be back
tomorrow morning.
Yeah.
Okay.
And, then and so you have to get me before 9:30.
No, not a problem.
Then I'll come in back from Hartford, and I will be here until 5:30, and then across the street at the Selectmen's Association.
It would be before 9:30 anyway.
Okay.
So, yeah.
I realize now that I have to keep more track of my time than ever before.
Put one of those collars around your ankle. We'll know where you are.
This is going to be, I'm going to be mental probably by the time this happens, but that's all right.
That's politically incorrect.
I know. Oh, yes, you are absolutely correct. I'm sorry. But I will be pulling out my hair. I'll be pulling out my hair. Here you go, Zach.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks for your team's work on that, too.
They did an outstanding job.
Yep.
This was no small feat. So.
It was a nice presentation the other night. So
great.
Excited.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
See you later.
Next item on the agenda is the assistant town clerk's pay grade. We have that paperwork here. This started circulating August right here. This is
The one from Barbara?
Yes.
Yep.
August 8th?
Yeah.
Okay.
August 8th was her first request, and then it went to the Personnel Committee, and the Personnel Committee just reviewed it at their September 26th meeting and agreed to that she should be based on her skills and experiences. So this is a recommendation to start at $13.62.
It's grade one, step three.
Yeah. So I will entertain a motion.
Does this, how do I say, coincide with our new pay scales, or have that not been implemented yet?
That has not been implemented. Okay. We've been doing this
okay.
based on the new pay scale, the adjusted ones that will be coming. But we've been doing all this individually.
So my concern was that, so if you read this grade one, step three, and there's a dollar amount attached to it, but if you look at our current grade scale, the numbers aren't going to match. That's what my concern was.
And that's why
so shouldn't this be altered to... I mean, I'm not arguing for the dollar amount. It's just that if somebody goes to look, you know, the things don't jive. And
I think what would happen, if I'm not mistaken, so we would hire at this, and then if we accepted or adjusted or whatever the new grade schedule, everybody would jump to whatever
we,
that new one.
We would slot her in wherever this
would fall
fits.
So at that
the
rate.
Pay would stay the same.
Correct.
It's just the numbers of the grade and stuff.
Right.
Exactly. Yep.
But we can't accept the new compensation because you can't go backwards, and there are some of the
okay.
pay grades that are backwards. So we have to sort this out.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know there's an issue, so we have to work on it. So I'll take a motion.
Go ahead. I make a motion that we accept the personnel board's request and approval of the grade one, step three pay of $13.62.
You know what? I'm supposed to be keeping minutes. So you're going to second it, right? I'm sorry.
Yep. A second.
All right. So Kip made the motion. Sorry, guys. Just a minute.
Right. The minutes are going to be easy to approve next week.
Yeah. Yeah. Is it going to be abbreviated? Okay. And all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 3-0.
No, she already has started.
She already started. The pay increase,
August, 10th, right?
August
22nd. That's when she was hired.
So it starts standing out now.
Correct.
Yes. So basically you already said yes.
Yes.
Now we say yes.
Now we are saying yes. She's being paid. This would be retroactive, Kathy. Yes. Yeah. Who made the ambulance motion?
I did.
Trevor did.
Okay. And you second it, right?
Yep.
Sorry.
That's okay.
And it's 3-0.
And then for the minutes.
Oh, for
I
the
did
minutes.
As well.
Oh, okay. Minutes, Trevor.
And the payroll. Thank you.
And we amended 3-0. And it was amended, which one was amended?
That was the first one.
Yes, it was the 21st.
Yep,
I'm going to give her that, but
yep.
I just want to make sure that she has amended.
Yep.
21st. Okay. I forgot that I have to get this to her. No show on this guy. All right, DS contractor evaluation forms.
Mm-hmm.
I'm putting you in charge of that, Kip.
Yay.
But I'm not entirely happy with the scores. I thought the scores should be higher.
Oh, I don't get to fill it out? I just get to look at it?
No, yeah. It was already pre-filled out. Didn't you see that?
No,
I did.
Who filled it out?
I don't know who filled it out.
I don't know. I mean, I'm assuming that...
Wasn't it supposed to be our evaluation?
No.
Well, Alicia did it. Alicia or whatever.
Where did I see that?
No, I did not.
Oh, I think I put it.
And there was no evaluation of them. I thought that was
no,
the one.
No, that's what that was interesting when I
yeah,
read
I went through the
it.
Whole thing.
I
said, oh my God, this
Pinkman.
Huge amount of paperwork, and there was not anything that,
well,
and no room for comment or
and
anything.
We can, who do we send that to them or to the
well,
MSBA?
We're supposed
I think it's MMA,
to,
right? Or
well, we can add our own then.
No, the thing was already filled out, and it goes back to them, and they, I don't know.
Yeah, standard contractor evaluation form for public bidding. And I am not sure
see,
who...
See, here, all the...
Oh, reference. Senior project manager.
But see, all the points are filled out. Didn't you get this copy?
Can you pull that out for
me?
Just to look at real quick.
Yep, absolutely.
You didn't get that? How did you not get it?
I think...
Was it in our mailbox?
I think it was, along
yes,
with the...
Yes, it was last
draft
week.
...draft warrant.
I mean, you don't have to do it tonight.
No, I just...
I mean, I thought the scores were not bad.
But they were
borderline.
Borderline.
Yeah.
And I think the contractor...
And our contractor
thought,
was really good.
Better.
He was very good.
Yeah.
The contractor was the only one good for this whole thing.
I know. And then there was no part for us to do the OPM. And
right.
So,
I was wondering about the OPM, like why wouldn't we?
I'm sorry to task you with that, but
I'm more than happy to, because you know I know this like the back of my hand,
right.
And I have everything right from the very first day that we met here, and the people from RDM wouldn't even let us as the owners pick out the color of the shingle,
right.
And I remember Patty getting upset, and the guy just said, "Well, that's the designer's choice." And I said, no, it's a person who pays for him's choice,
yeah.
You know?
And
he says, well, I'm not going to allow that. And that's... And
that's where it all began.
Yeah. So I'll find it.
Okay. I mean, you're welcome to this
topic,
so, if you want.
I think, Trevor, what the consensus is, we don't need to vote on it, but
next week I'll bring it to you.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And
okay.
We can discuss it then, okay?
I only want you to... I thought the scores were too low, and that was your consensus,
I
right?
I thought so, too.
So I want to make sure that it reflects that they were wonderful. And then I also want, somehow, the OPM and the designer, we're supposed to grade them.
I have pages of notes on them, so yeah.
Yeah.
And there's nothing for us to fill
out. Right, there was nothing on those.
And like I was telling Trevor, and I do not believe that I'm exaggerating, I have 800 or 900 emails from Pink and RDA.
I have most
it's
of them myself, and it's disgusting. So I have them saved in a file. If you lose them, I have my own copies.
Unless my computer blows up.
If you need this, let me know.
Okay. No, I must have it.
Yeah.
You do have it, because I think. But
yeah.
Okay.
What was shocking to me, though, is we got to get the OPM thing
done.
Yeah,
absolutely.
And the designer one. I want to make sure we have input on that. There has to be a form. I can't think
of the gentleman's name now, but I spoke to a man and a woman, and I think the woman's name was Ann, at Mass School Building Authority during the middle of all this, and I shared my complaint.
Yep.
And then I tried to call her back when they threatened to stop working unless we signed that extension. And that's when that gentleman called me back, and I laid it all out to him, and he said, well, wait till it's all done, then let us know. So.
Wow.
I definitely will.
And I'm not
Do you
sure.
have the final, we don't have a final bill yet, though.
No,
I was concerned about that because Doug was following that pretty carefully, but I spoke to Brenda, and she said that she'll kind of watch it. But I've also been in contact with Matt Prody, and I asked him about anything that's lingering, and he said everything is 100% done, with one exception. And that just has to do with a part that they're waiting for the air conditioning controls.
Okay.
But
one thing I will note is that a lot of these, they all say preliminary evaluation, and then there's, and it has subcontractor or contractor, but no final evaluation. So maybe the final, there's a bigger packet on it.
But,
a lot of them say preliminary or 50% and preliminary back here, too. So it looks like there's another one that will be done. It looks like this would be the district and the OPM would sign off on this one. But so maybe there's another whole evaluation packet to come, but.
All right.
What?
Where does it go? Who gets
it? It goes back to the state.
To the state.
I'll find out.
Okay.
I'll look into that too.
Thank you, Kip. I appreciate that. And if you want me to sign off on that too, another witness, and Dick.
Yeah,
I mean, I think, and I'm not saying that you can't sign off. I'm just saying that.
No, he's been involved.
Dick and I were witness to
everything,
too.
Well, you sat through some of those meetings. You sat
absolutely. But we went to those meetings, and so I can certainly back it up. I'm just, I just was, because you are more technically versed on this, I thought it was really...
Yeah, I have no problem, and I'll review it, and I'll bring it back.
I just didn't want it to be so low. And Trevor's right. I just want to make sure the final thing is correct, because this is preliminary, and if we send it back, do we get to see the final?
Right.
I mean, do they just change the numbers and then, I don't know. I mean, I just want to make sure that we're doing what we have to do. Okay. Now, this is business not previously anticipated. We have a public records request that came in from John Pachorek for the new monetization bill.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to have Debbie Austin appointed as our access officer.
Yep.
But in reality, this is the way I understand this Monetization Act. I'm not 100% on board yet, but from the way I read it, we have to develop a policy first. And then the town clerk is like our, usually in most towns, especially our size, the town clerk would be the access officer, records officer, and then you do supplemental ones, like then we would appoint Debbie for the police, because the police would be separate.
Maybe I misread, but I think that's what John was asking, is that she be for the police department, not for all.
But we can't appoint her first if we don't have a policy. And I think,
See,
that's the way I do it.
Mm-hmm.
And when I talked to Barbara, because I didn't know how complicated a policy, I mean, do we have to have meetings? And then we vote to adopt it or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's really not that complicated, because it's almost all outlined in the Modernization Act. But truthfully, Barbara does not have any time between now and the elections.
Okay.
But once the elections are over, sort of like towards, you know, a week or two after, when she's filed all her paperwork, then we can sit down with her and do a policy. So is that okay?
Yep. That's fine.
You know, no one is out there saying that we have to do this by, you know, X date.
Right.
This is,
and we're accommodating people that do with us now.
Yeah, I mean, we always have, so it's not an issue. But
I
just want to say that is...
So in November.
It's, as usual, John Pachorek is on top of things, and I just want to make sure that you understand that request, because it was sent to all of us.
Correct.
And we can't deliberate on this. So
right.
What I did was try to sort out what we have to do
first,
and when we have to do stuff. And since we're in a kind of emergency situation here until we get staff. So that's not something we're going to do right away.
Okay.
But I was not just tabling it without letting you guys know.
No,
and that's kind
good.
Of what we're going to do.
That's fine.
Is why we're going to meet every week, so
mm-hmm.
I can tell you what's happening.
Okay.
And
sounds
let you
good.
Know what's going on, so everyone knows that we're not like doing anything in violation of anything.
Perfect.
Okay. The other thing that came in was the one-day liquor license request for DA in November. I mean, obviously you can let it sit, but they do this on a regular basis.
Yep.
Let's see.
I know we've done a couple before.
I hope it's here, because I just. What I was trying to do on that is, you know, they...
Yeah, here it is.
Oh, here it is.
Yep.
We have, like I said, this is a request for...
Tuesday the 1st?
November 1st, right. And we're meeting every week, so it's not a big deal. But it came in, they paid their bills, they know... I mean, we never have any issues with them. And I'm trying to move it out.
Can
so
we make
that
a motion?
Poor, yeah, so poor Pat doesn't become... overwhelmed with stuff building up.
Thing.
Yeah, so.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay, I'll take a motion on this.
To make a motion to approve the one-day liquor license for wine and malt for Deerfield Academy on November 1st, 2016.
I'll second the motion.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Nope.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Let me just write down that our action on it.
Yep.
Okay. She can just use a stamp on this. This
mm-hmm.
shouldn't be an issue.
Okay.
And let me just write okayed. Next item on the agenda is Pat Kroll, a temporary pay increase for Pat. We have a memo from Doug for $3 an hour to do out-of-grade work. Basically...
taking up all the work that Doug...
Some of the data entry stuff that she was doing, Brenda has taken back.
Okay.
And is handling. Priscilla is coming over and on Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday, and we're helping go through mail and stuff. But otherwise, Pat is the sole person.
And she'll be doing a lot of
work. So what's the out-of-grade work?
She'll be organizing whatever.
Our meetings?
Our meetings, the paperwork. It's
not
really
out of grade. Is that something that should go to the personnel board, do you think?
Well, we have two line items in the budget that we are not spending, and somebody's doing the work.
And it's not a permanent?
No, it's from today when we vote it to when we get somebody in the office. We can change it whenever.
Right.
But it's until, and there is precedent. We've done.
I just kind of see a little hornet's nest brewing here because I don't know what it is. Let's just say that the out-of-grade work is making up, and I shouldn't even say this, like a breakfast list. Okay, so she does this and she's doing it all along. Now, we do hire somebody, but, you know, because that person's busy doing this, she continues to make the breakfast list. Then all of a sudden, well, even though, you know, we got more help, I'm still doing this what I was getting paid for before. And do you know what I'm saying?
Well, actually, in the past, what we've done when we've had these transitions is we've, because we've had salary lines we had not expended, we did bonuses for people covering, which is what, I don't want to say bonuses, but whatever. What did we call it?
Out of rate pay or something?
Well, what we did is a lump sum at the end of the transition that covered the extra work. And that's what I actually would have preferred to do, but Doug generated this memo and...
Well, that's, you know, there was an explanation on one of the employees that actually was used to get paid by the hour. And because he took on a lot of extra work, he would have made more money because he would have been getting time and a half. I get that. But just because if somebody has a job to do and it was sweeping the garage, let's say, and, you know, for a time being, not only they have to sweep it, but they have to pick it up, that's out of grade and pay them extra for that. I don't get it because it isn't like they're spending more time doing it. It's just instead of filing stuff here, they're filing it there. You know what I'm saying?
Well,
because everybody that works in the town steps up to the plate and does a little bit more. I mean, our building inspector does a lot of things.
I know, constantly.
You know, and he does this and does that. And, you know, we don't say, well, let's give him an extra $5,000 because he, you know what I'm saying? And I think this is a way that, although there's one person involved, that it gets out and other people become, well, wait a minute, you know, I do this. And
well, I think the reason why Doug generated this, because I had anticipated that we would do some kind of thing at the end of whenever this,
or
you know,
we would
just
hire
see,
somebody now,
or we would hire somebody additional in the office.
And I mean, do the work.
But
right,
but I think
that was
what,
one of the things I want to talk about tonight too. But
well, I think what when Diana Damon left the senior center, we asked Sue Corey to do some additional work, and that's where this was generated from because it was the same kind of thing. They end up covering extra work.
And then did that pay change after a while, or did it just maintain the same?
No, it went back. So, mm-hmm. And then I'm assuming that, or my assumption is that Brenda would hand back the data entry to Pat when Pat has more time.
That's my issue. There's not
just get $3 an hour.
It's not extra work. It's just different work.
It's different work.
But so I'm still saying. So
we'll table this. Kathy, the reason why we have not discussed this is because this is, you know, this is a first time discussion. So this is not going to be general discussion because we have to do our business in public. But that does not mean that we're going to take comments from the audience, because this is first time run, okay, for us. So if you have comments, you can feel free to contact us individually, but we can't we're not going to have general discussion for the audience, okay? Because we can't. We'll be here for 5 hours a night, and we can't. So it's not. I don't mean to be rude, but we're trying to meet the open meeting law requirements and have discussion of items, and this is first time for all of us. Normally, what would happen is Doug would have sent out this memo. We would have transmitted to him our issues, and then the discussion would be framed before we came in to the meeting so that we could continue the discussion. But this is first time review, and so we have some discussion. So
my discussion on it is, so we're at a point right now where we we don't have anybody in the office other than Pat.
That's correct.
So we have a choice to either give her more responsibility and pay her more for that, or we hire a temporary person to come in and do that work. I'm thinking this is probably a more economical way to go, but I could be swayed either way. I don't know.
Well, we're asking everyone to take on additional work. Mm-hmm. So obviously $3 an hour long term, if we're going to go for months. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you're going to be on the review committee. So
right.
To me, it's very important that we get somebody competent. Mm-hmm. So if you do not feel that we have anybody, then we're going to go out
right.
advertise again. So
yep.
potentially this could be
right.
for a while. And we're going to have to adjust because, you know, it will be, it's additional workload, no matter
right.
how you.
Mm.
But I am going in there. Like, I went to the, between this afternoon before my capital improvement meeting, I ran to the registry to register this deed. So there are
other things.
Things that she's going to have to do. She's the sole person if I'm not around to do it. Or anybody, there's no one else.
No, I get that. And, you know, besides the town administrator, I still think that we could use another person in that office
mm-hmm.
too.
Right.
Besides that, and you know, we had Kat there for a short amount of time, and I think that would be a good place to, you know, bring somebody in. You know, the advantage that Pat has is because she knows where everything is. You bring somebody else in, you know, you're going to lose a good week just trying to show them where everything is and stuff
well,
like that.
Well, my only hesitation on that is if you bring someone in cold, number one, municipal work is different. And number two, it messes everything up. It truly is more economical to pay somebody a little bit more than to bring someone in cold. Now, if you bring in somebody like Wendy, I'm hoping that Wendy will have more than a day a week to spend.
Oh, I mean, I understand her situation. So mm-hmm. if she can't. But, you know, we need to do something, you know.
I know. So, well, let's table this then.
Okay.
And let's try to figure out some other, you know, some strategies. But I, mm-hmm. I do believe that this is the cheapest solution.
Okay.
But, and the
we'll
best.
Think about it
and
for
the
a
best.
Week.
My only thing about bringing someone in cold is there's no one here to supervise.
Well,
you're putting in a weird situation.
And you're pulling all this extra work away from Pat to now train somebody for when she could be doing the actual work. Maybe once we have the new administrator, and like Kip said, bringing somebody else in as well, so two positions like we have always maybe had years ago. I know it's been like leapfrog
well,
for a while, but
you'll be able to we'll have more discussion on this next week because you'll have an idea of what
yeah.
we're looking at
yep.
long term.
Okay.
When is that meeting, next week?
It's not till the 13th, I think.
Next week. It's next Wednesday.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we can start. We'll just discuss
this
again.
Is it going to be
again.
On TV?
No.
I don't think so. No, that's all.
That's why you can't go. Come on.
I think
watch
it's all
on TV.
Executive session because people who are coming in may not want their employers to
Let's
know
not go here. Down that road we did last time, though, please.
No.
Okay.
I wasn't here for that, but.
No, they were trying to avoid that.
Okay.
Okay, so we'll table that.
Right.
The other thing is the Whiteman subdivision. That was filed and signed by the planning board. Kip, maybe you can give us a little information on that. That was a preliminary plan, and because it is somewhat controversial, we're trying to keep the timelines, and one of the timelines is we have 45 days, which is
as
October.
As Board of Health as well, right?
As Board of Health to sign off if we have any concerns. Right?
I'm gonna be very broad with this. I did not see any problems that this would have on the town as far from a Board
from
of Health
issue
point of view. The subdivision, in my opinion, would only help our sewage treatment plant at this point, because one of the biggest problems that we have is not enough flow.
Right.
So that would be all right. I do know that there were some residents that were concerned about chemicals that had been used on that land in prior years, and that they were of a nature that didn't break down, and I'm not a chemical engineer, so I don't really understand it. And I looked into it real briefly, and I did have discussions with Dick as to, you know, is there something that we should check into as far as, you know, what could be in those soil that would be harmful. The only thing that I did come into is that in years gone by, that there were some town-owned wells over near the water department that could not be used because they were contaminated with pesticides. And that has since changed, and they've cleared out. I don't really know if those wells are going to go back online or not, but, you know, it seems to make sense to me that if they're not showing up in the water anymore, that maybe they have dissipated, but I don't know. That would be the only thing that I could...
Do you think that might show up in their study? And I mean, so this is I guess back up my question. This is a preliminary approval as Board of Health, and then when they come up again with a definitive, do we have another go at it? Once we have, safety, we have traffic studies, that kind of thing.
That's not the Board of Health's issue. That's all the planning board.
Okay.
And besides, you know, six of us looking at it, the police of safety.
Yeah.
You know, we looked at it, and we hired Pat Smith from the FERCOG, and she did a very detailed analysis of the plan and actually laid out every single section of our bylaw, and she put either complied or did not comply, and every one of them complied.
Okay.
So we found that there was no justification not to approve that preliminary plan,
right.
And so it goes to the next step.
Yeah.
But from the Board of Health point of view, I
don't see anything either. Like
no.
Like you said, the flow will be beneficial to our...
The sewer treatment.
The sewer treatments, because there isn't enough right now. So.
The only concern, or the concern that I have on this, and that should be addressed in the definitive plan, is retention and detention ponds.
Mm-hmm.
I do not, we cannot have mosquito breeding.
I, you know what?
So
I can't believe I'm going to say this. I agree with you. But, you know, unfortunately, that's part of what's happening in our society. I mean, why the state decided to keep water on the property and, put it back in the ground. I mean, the overall thought of it is good. You want to save it. But, you know, the center of Deerfield has had a high groundwater problem forever.
Yeah.
And, you know, unless there's a major earthquake that changes the water under the ground, it's probably going to remain like that. And the best thing that this community could do is to have some catch basins that were piped and pipe the water off to the river. I mean, that's what they used to do. But
sure.
Now we've become so smart that we create more problems for ourselves. And these retention ponds, you're right. If you do have heavy rain, even if the water goes in there, the topsoil is so saturated it stays wet. It's perfect breeding ground for mosquitoes.
Yep.
And so our solution is what? Put chemicals on it to kill them. You know, it's crazy.
Well, I think we should vote to, I guess we sign off on as a preliminary plan, mm-hmm. with the caveat that the peer review engineers address our concerns about water, right?
Yeah, I guess it can. I mean, they're kind of stuck
right.
between a rock and hard place. You know, they could say, okay, we agree with you, but we have to keep the water.
The
law requires us to keep it on site.
But there's ways that you can do this. You can do a rain garden. You can do, there's many things you can do that will eliminate the mosquitoes.
You can do a rain garden, but these retention ponds are designed for thousands of gallons of water.
But you can do a giant.
Like, what's a rain garden? You
well,
plant
well,
vegetation.
You can put rocks.
You can put Joe Pye weed in it. You know,
okay.
I mean, it can be you know, stuff that sucks up.
Sucks up a lot of water.
A lot of water. It's a, you put gravel.
Yep.
And you know, it can be, it's like you do the same retention pond, but then you cover it with gravel.
Yeah.
And then you cover it with soil, and you're water-sucking plants.
And then all the
water. So the
way
water
down under.
Is underground.
Yeah.
And the plants suck up
whatever's
excess water, and I mean it works all over.
Yeah.
You know, and that's sort of like the new green thing to do. But people have been doing it for years. It's
yeah.
not new.
Okay.
But it does work, and it doesn't cost.
A lot of
any.
People used to put weeping willows in the yard because they suck up a lot of water
yeah.
until they invaded their septic systems, and it cost them tens of thousands of dollars. And,
well,
cut the tree down and move on.
You got to put weeping willows.
And the other thing, too, that I, you know, only being involved with this, I caution any type of regulation or movement that creates a lot of this, if, I don't want to say green space, but plants that have to be maintained. I mean, this
right.
community spent an awful lot of money for plantings around the highway garage, and
did
most of them just been mowed over. And, you know,
yeah.
it's
no,
it's kind
that
of
was
foolish
a mistake. By the architects. Don't
well,
blame
I,
it on our highway guys.
I didn't blame it on the highway guys. I said at the highway department, you know, when they built
no.
it. I understand that. But they, those plants should not have been there.
It was architectural quality of our architect at the end. We had a good one at the start, and
right.
it was replaced with somebody that was not qualified.
My point is I'd hate to see any
right.
any regulations that make anyone
but,
pay for a lot of plants
you,
that
I
aren't
know.
Going to be maintained. You know.
Right, but... If you have a peer review, the peer review would give you the correct feedback, right?
Well, the peer review for
I
the
mean,
site
would,
plan review wouldn't even get into that.
But they have to do the calculations in a rain garden or a retention pond that has a rain garden application would.
I don't know if there's a requirement that it has that.
But that's
they just have to manage the water on site.
We're responding to this, Kip, as a board of health. You are not on the planning board. You are responding to this as a board of health. And the fact is you're putting a mosquito breeding area in the middle of a residential area. And so it is a concern of the board of health that you don't generate this.
So, I don't know. They should be able to. Right?
Yes.
I mean, isn't that hard?
That's why you have
right.
engineers
so
design
ask,
this.
So we ask them to review.
This is
and
a concern. We have, there are, the, what we are concerned with it appears to have no concern other than we don't want a retention pond, which is what we've been trying to do for years. And we tell people that they have to do some kind of alternative thing.
Or we could just make a bylaw that everybody buys a unit that has to put two quart bottles and fill it with sugar water and have holes only bent in one way.
Okay.
I
will
pass.
Entertain a motion.
I make a motion to comment on the is that all we're doing is commenting? Right?
I think see
think
we've never
the
done
board,
this
the
before.
The Board of Health I think just comments either has
yeah.
a comment. I don't think we
see within 45 days after submission of the preliminary plan, each board shall notify the applicant and the clerk of the city by certified mail, which or not, we're just going to walk it across, that the plan has been approved. So what we're doing is approving the preliminary plan, but noting our concerns about so that the applicant is aware that that's our
concern. We're worried about
right.
a mosquito
so
pond in there.
We're I don't want to say it's signed off. So your motion should be that we are approving the preliminary plan. Noting our concern on retention ponds and the potential for mosquito breeding grounds.
So moved.
I'll second it.
Okay. So you made the motion, and the motion is to sign.
That was an entertaining motion.
Yeah, I know. I'm sorry. I got to write it down. So we are signing off. I don't think we should say sign off. We have to say we're approving. Approve.
Right.
Okay, so you made the motion to approve.
The preliminary.
The preliminary plan. Noting concerns for retention. Do you know if it's a retention or a detention pond? We'll just put
retention.
Down both.
Retention, right. Talking about swales and then what? Some
big pits.
Right in front, like, just like at the school?
Yeah.
Okay. And potential for...
Which is pretty dry over there, I think, right?
It is this year.
But maybe I should say once again that that pipe is still plugged up and nobody has taken care of it. Yeah.
So how do we get that done?
It's only cleaned out by 6 feet, and that's because I shoveled it. And I'm not going to go all the way across that field. So
is that truck that's driven around here every so often, is that what you use, or do we have equipment to do that?
We have equipment to do it. I mean, Kevin could do it. I just...
How do we direct him to do that?
I don't know. The issue... Well, here again, because the school takes care of the maintenance there. So, I mean, are we stepping on anybody's toes if we ask Kevin to go over and do that? Or
we need to talk to Lynn. We'll talk to Lynn.
Okay.
And figure out how we can work this out.
Yeah.
She's wonderful.
Yeah, she's been great.
I've had several conversations with her. We can sort it out.
Yep.
So, okay, if there's no further, and you need to authorize me to sign.
Authorize.
Because I'm going to be here.
Chair, Carolyn.
To sign.
To sign.
Okay. Yep. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
You can sign it. You can use a stamp if you want.
No. I'm going to sign. I need to read what we do, make sure. There's nobody else checking my work, so I got to make sure. Okay, we have, I will come in tomorrow and get a check for the dinner tomorrow. I picked up the raffle present.
Thank you.
It's a fruit basket from Clarkdale and
nice.
Some cider.
Okay.
So we're going to Chandler's.
At 5:30.
At 5:30.
Yep. Yes, and then I've got to leave a little. I have a 6 o'clock school committee meeting, but I'm going to go for my 7 school committee meeting.
Okay. What I thought
I'm
is
stay as long as I can.
I don't know when the next one is because we have a e-board meeting next Tuesday night, but. I will get the next meeting, and then I thought, you know what, we could invite Lynn to the next one. It'll probably be like the first week in December or something like that. We have to
That'd
set
be
the
great.
Date. It usually is related to budgets, and you know, our legislators will be there. So
that's a good idea then.
You know, it's the budget forecast one. So I thought it would be a good opportunity to have her introduce her to Steve Kulik and Stan Rosenberg. And
perfect.
See if we can follow up on that small rural school initiative and tell them that we absolutely cannot take a cut from the governor.
Absolutely.
From schools.
Right.
And rah-rah, all that kind of stuff.
Yep.
Regional transportation. So between now and then, I'll find out. Once we get the date, I'll let you know and we can invite her. But then what we'll do is I'll do some kind of chart. When I first was selectman, because I'll just update it, but it was like 32 or 33% of the cost of a student the state was paying, and now now we're below 20%.
Absolutely.
I think this past year. So, who's making it up but taxpayers? So, what we have to do is we'll do a new chart. Pat's usually pretty good with that. So, I'll develop the chart and we'll hand it out at that meeting and kind of do some kind of.
Discussion
with Steve that we've got to do it, and that group is that group meeting again one more
I
time.
I thought yes, I was under the impression it was next week.
Day? I have a meeting every night next week.
Skip that. I think it was the end of the month, October, like 25th.
Oh, okay.
24th, 25th. I don't think it was settled yet.
Oh, okay.
I had it 24th.
I was originally on that email chain, and then somehow I got dropped.
I have not seen an email since.
Oh, you haven't.
So,
okay.
One thing I did want to mention is that.
Do you want to follow up? Could I ask you to
follow
up?
Yes, absolutely. I'll find out what the date is and where we're at.
And try to get him to do it on that Tuesday because we have a meeting scheduled on the 26th already.
Okay.
Offer our place is fine.
Sure.
We can do here.
Shelburne, I think, was going to take
do
it over.
I know, but there was some question, and I was like.
All right. Yeah, we'll hear.
If it looked like they were hesitating because they didn't have a place, make sure
they know it's available.
It's available.
Okay. One thing I did want to mention was that I had received an email from Frontier. There's a government course going on over there, and maybe you've seen it too, where they were looking to interview for the upcoming election. They were looking to interview local people in town government. And Frontier was So I think it was on the 11th they were looking for people to come in and just do a 15-minute interview on town government, how kids can get involved. I know we had talked about this before. Then
I did that a couple years ago.
Yeah, and it may be a continuation of that. Yeah. On the 8th election night, they're looking for, you know, 15-minute time slots if anybody wanted to talk about the election or about anything. So they're looking to interview and do,
okay,
trying to. So I've offered to do both nights, and then.
Oh, that's really
and
sweet.
And if anybody else wanted to.
Yeah, I'd do it. They might not like what I say, but I'll do it.
Can you forward that email to Pat so that
yes.
she can give Kip and I the information?
Yep,
therefore,
absolutely.
We're not violating any meeting law.
Sure.
Well, he told me about it now, so.
Well,
yep.
It's okay, because okay. we're in, but we can't.
No, I know.
We can't have, like, anything go between
no,
us.
I know.
Yep.
So just forward it to Pat, and then Pat will get it to Kip and I.
Yep.
Can I mention a few things?
Kevin Murphy.
Oh, yeah. There's a couple more things I wanted
okay.
to make sure. Brenda, she's almost done the recap. She's almost, she's got a couple things that are hanging. She's still outstanding, it's almost done, which is really good. That's earlier than we've had in the past. And the certified cash came in.
Great.
And we have... 1,585,583 in free cash. So
the ambulance fund is quite a bit too.
Yeah, well, we just took a big hit.
Well, then you go subtract the 269,000 from
that.
So
that's still good because
yes.
yeah,
you know,
we're not
looking to appropriate
no.
the money from taxation.
No.
I mean,
and
I guess in one hand, it's already taken there anyways.
No, but it's good. I mean, I think they're. They had about 100,000 from that we carried over, and then we had 400,000, and that's.
Yep.
It's part of the startup. It's a little rough, but you know the numbers, and that's what we can get into that if you want to, because that's one of my things that I was going to build. What I did is I went to Barbara, and so let me back up. Okay, and I hope you don't. I know you've worked so hard on this, but I'm going to ask you to do a little bit more work on your plan, because if we're going to build this, okay, it doesn't make sense to you. What you designed was something comparable for the space in Waitley, but I've been going through the books, and Zach just signed the intercept for agreement with Greenfield and Montague, and it's very clear that Medicare.
They're on the way out.
Yeah, they're not making money on emergency runs. Their money maker is to do the scheduled hospital runs. So we are picking up runs, and we're going to have more. And Conway is having some real problems with meeting their calls, and they're basically waiting for Northampton to come up. And we wouldn't pick up all of Conway's calls because it doesn't make sense from geographic layout. We've talked in the past where
right.
different services in the hills would pick up different sections just based on...
Because it's such a big town.
Yeah, right. I mean, it's
right.
you're driving all over the place. But if we are, in fact, making all these runs to Greenfield and Montague and Conway, and you had talked in the past where you're putting on an extra bay is like $20,000, can you just tap out 4 or 5 bays on the design?
Well, sure. I mean, the short answer is sure. But
it's
the thing is...
because we're doing a 30-year building. This is what my thought was. We have growth. The numbers are there for the runs. It just doesn't make sense to borrow money for, you know, what we're going to shoehorn ourselves into right now. I mean, the critical thing is to get under one roof
and
get the operation going. And if DA or whoever donated us the building, yes, we'd take it. But if we're going to actually go out and finance our building, we over a 30-year loan, I mean, it's got to be a 30-year building. So we have to have a little bit more bunk room space. And one of the things that is striking me as really needful already is a desk space for just clerical person. It doesn't make sense.
Well, there's three offices in there, and one of the offices is large enough to hold four desks. So
Oh, okay.
If they're not.
Well, but and the bays is what I was.
The bay, sure. Adding another bay is very simple to do.
So then I went to Barbara and I said, well, you know, based on your estimates, you know, this was going to cost the building if it was donated. This is what, just double that if it was public procurement. So what I did is I asked Barbara what a 30-year loan would be for, at current, you know, ballpark current rates. Mm-hmm. And so she looked it up, and it's $3,700 a month. So it's certainly within the ballpark, and it makes sense. But that's why I didn't want us to build something that is for today, when clearly we got growth potential, and we have growth.
Well, I'm looking at the big picture, and that, you know, I so far everything that I most
I'm
everything
just
that I see.
I'm just saying,
why
you be mad with
me? Why would I be mad? No,
well,
not at all.
It's because you put too much time into this already.
No, that's all right. Changing stuff like that is simple. I'm just, I don't want to say concerned. I think about this whole thing a lot, and it's, to me, it's like, are we providing for our ambulance service, or is this public funding a small business? Do you know what I'm saying? It's like, we don't, our highway department, we don't contract our trucks to go and fix roads in Conway or whatever and stuff like that. But that's what we're doing with the ambulance service. And I understand that, you know, you need to help out other communities, and we're making money on this. But I'm unclear as to which ambulances go on these runs, and are you answering emergency calls in these other towns, or just transporting people, where there's a difference? You know, if there's
no, it's
somebody
emergency intercepts are emergency
emergencies
paramedic level.
So
because they have their own basic.
So if we have, I think that at the risk of running of sounding selfish, I would hate to spend all this money for high tech ambulance, and when a resident Deerfield needs it, find out, well, this ambulance is in Sunderland, or it's in Conway, or not Sunderland, but Amherst. Or, you know what I'm saying?
Oh,
or
absolutely.
Montague, and that we're helping everybody else, but the taxpayers are paying for most of this, and I want it here.
Unfortunately, EMS is set up like the fire department.
Right.
Just like
mutual aid. I get it.
It's mutual aid. And so you had,
but
when you do paramedic stuff, we're a paramedic level service, so we
And I get that, but it's like if you want to use a fire department, you know, if there's a fire in Hatfield and they call for mutual aid, people come from all over to help, which is great. And what I'm saying is that if other communities don't fund having a good ambulance service, but Deerfield chooses, our taxpayers say, hey, look, you know what, this is important to us. We're going to pay for this, and find out that they're going elsewhere, you know. That's a problem.
So we'd have to keep an eye on that, right?
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying about, you know, how fast you grow and stuff like that. So changing the building is not an issue. That's
right.
Okay.
That's
but that's what I
would. And good, I would not get mad.
Good conversation to have.
Yeah,
but we have to have that conversation.
Oh, you definitely.
Because,
have okay.
But the growth is there, and you're going to have that anyway. Yep. Because you're obligated to do that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very quickly, because I've been following this whole scenario for several years, as you're well aware.
Sure.
And that was one of my major concerns. When this was brought to annual town meeting for a vote to create the South County, it was explained to the population that we were creating a three-town district for ambulance services. And the goal was to provide a good service for the residents of those three towns. Mm-hmm. And it was going to cost X amount of dollars. They have achieved that goal as far as their response times, and kudos. Mm-hmm. You know, nobody that I've heard of is arguing about the service. That is not the case. But I don't think it was created to grow it into a full-time business and continue this. I'm getting nervous because all these meetings I'm attending, I keep hearing, well, we don't know where we're going to be. Well, we may need to add on, and so on. That was not the intention that was presented to the people of the three towns. We are meeting our goal of what was intended and what the residents of the three towns were told. Now we're talking about growing the business, adding bays, adding more additional vehicles, adding additional staff, adding additional retirements. Is this going to be cost effective? You know, we're getting calls in that, but what we're bringing in, the revenue that we're bringing in, is offsetting the expenses.
We have to look into it.
So these are some of the issues that we really need to take a look at before we jump into this with both feet. And as a taxpayer, I don't want to be supporting a quasi-business. And, you know...
Unfortunately, you can't have it both ways, because we are running the town as best we can as a quasi-business, okay? And so Jeff, we are very concerned about that, and we will be addressing it.
It's a good point.
And it is
a
good point.
Well, I'm just saying, though, it wasn't presented to the people at the annual town meeting. The annual town meeting, the goal was stated that they were going to take the ambulance service, was going to provide a paramedic level for the three towns, the residents of the three towns, and we're going to secure that. And they've done that. They've accomplished that goal. I'm looking at the budget, bottom line. Now, if we start doing these other things that's being discussed, is that going to increase the bottom line for the taxpayers?
I think the only...
And we have to really take a look at that, because we have to make sure that if we're talking about expanding and that stuff, that's going to be cost-effective. If we're talking about expansion, it should be reducing that bottom line,
correct,
not increasing it.
Correct.
And that's what I think, that's the whole goal of this.
Absolutely.
And well, I'd like to see that.
Yeah, because I feel the same way you do. The goal is not to provide service throughout the whole Franklin County. It's really if by doing that we can reduce the bottom line and still give paramedic level service in an instant to our residents in the three towns.
Right.
I think that makes sense.
Response time.
Exactly.
Which I really want to
absolutely
restate
very important
that they're doing an excellent job with that, and they should get the recognition.
Correct.
Absolutely.
And where the building ends up.
But Jeff, that's what we're trying to do. But we're trying to make a decision based on long-term decision. We're trying to figure out what we're going to do.
But we really need to look at those
numbers. We will. And the numbers, I'm just starting to get into the numbers and getting up to speed, and that's what we're trying to do. But again, we have no opportunity to talk about this except in public. So we can't have people jumping all over us, because this is the only time we get to talk. And that's why... I understand your interest.
I just want to bring my concerns to your attention.
Yes.
But
I just want to encourage people to call us individually with the concerns and not have, I mean, like I said, we'll be here for 5 hours and we just can't.
Well, I say, I'm not upset with you people at all. It needs to be discussed. I am upset with some of the articles that I've seen recorded lately making Deerfield the bad people in the bad town. Because obviously they haven't done their homework. They don't have all the facts. And they're writing editorials making Deerfield look like they're the bad town. That's not the case at all. As I said, I followed this issue from day one. And there's a lot behind the scenes that the editors have not followed up on.
Well, everyone is trying to work together. And we're trying to come up with the best long-term solution. And I think we're moving ahead. And it's, like I said, I just didn't want Kip to be mad at me. But my thing is, you know, basically Whately's has no expansion possibilities. And if we're, you know, it makes sense. There's been talk about having this intercept or auxiliary vehicle. And so we're going to be, you know, we're already out of space. And so if we're going to do something, we need to make sure we have potential flexibility for growth. And it wasn't, I'm just saying the numbers are solid. I mean, the oversight board has been really, really conservative about hiring staff to the point where they shouldn't have been as conservative in my mind, given some of the overtime issues. So what we're trying to do is work and be involved and get up to speed, and that, because we're new. And like I said, Kip has put in a lot of commitment and time, and my thing was, I didn't want him mad at me, but if we're going to do anything...
I got over the mosquitoes a long time ago.
Okay. if we're going to do anything, it doesn't make sense in my mind not to do a 30-year building. You know,
it'll last a lot longer than 30 years.
Well, I know, but when you had said it's like only like another $20,000 or $30,000 to add base, let's just add the base up front. Let's not...
Well, you know, you got to keep...
Because going in later is so much more expensive.
Well, yes, that is true.
Unless it's 100% free building. Then whatever they give us is okay. I mean, then we will go back. But if we're going to have to commit and move forward, then I just want us to have a design that is big enough.
My turn?
Yes, and I don't mean that. I don't want you mad at me.
The thing about doing this is it's very easy to plan big, but, you know, the way I look at this is that we have a need, we need to fill that need, and we have to keep it financially responsible. Mm-hmm. You know, because when we ask taxpayers to pay for this, you know, you have to think about these people.
Absolutely,
you know, always.
Absolutely.
And some of us are fortunate and some of us just aren't. And some of us, you know, there's a lot of folks in this town that I've heard repeatedly, and I'm there now, have worked for 40, 50, 60, 70 years in this town and paid taxes, and now they can't work anymore. They're old, they're retired, they're getting very minimal money, and yet their tax bills just keep going up and up, and, you know, it's a vicious cycle. And so those are the people that I keep in mind. So when I build something that, you know, or come up with an idea, it's like, this is going to do the job. It's going to be good. It's not going to fall apart.
Yeah.
It's going to be energy efficient. And what's the least amount of money that we need to do this? You know,
and
that's it.
I'm not disagreeing. The most important thing is, from the bottom line, is to get us over into one roof.
Yep.
It doesn't matter where. It's just that there was, what was bothering me is there's not a lot of expansion room in the Whately situation. So
right.
If you're talking about temporary, and
right.
That doesn't, we need to, if this
have
is
the
a,
ability.
This is a going enterprise, and it's clearly, the numbers are solid, and we just need, I want to make sure we have a big enough building that we're not, as soon as we get in there, people aren't.
Right,
you're right back at the table asking for more.
Right,
that's
but you
worse.
Know, that's part of my caution thinking about growing this into a business, where it becomes is that if there were transports, like I was thinking, where you're taking people from nursing homes or from one hospital to the other.
Well, that's how you make money.
That's one thing. But if you're making emergency runs, you know,
right.
There's a good chance that, you know, you're not going to get paid for this.
Yeah.
And like Jeff said, you know, plus you get more staff, you know, and they go on. Eventually, you know, they're going to retire. So in the private sector, you make money and you have to put money aside. Well, in the community, you don't. You don't. You can't.
Well,
it's hard to tax people more to put it.
We aren't.
So what happens down the road is that, you know, along the line, oh, yeah, we're making money. We're paying for this. But then when these people start retiring, then that's where it becomes a real expense for this community, you know.
Okay.
But anyways,
I'm yep. Absolutely agree. That's why we're looking at the numbers.
Sure.
I mean, that's why we're.
Do you have anything else, or?
The Headworks property, we need to sort out.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you. One of the things is going into executive session a proper thing to do when you're discussing an acquisition of land, or?
Yes, but we have to. You can't. We can't just discuss it. We have to put that. We can put that on the agenda for next week.
Okay.
Okay, because that actually has to be a postage agenda item. Same as the sewer rate. Barb is okay with us doing the sewer rate next week, but she wasn't okay with us putting it off for two or three more weeks.
What?
She needs us to do a sewer rate for her bills. She has to do.
Well, I understand. Well, that was another thing I was going to talk about.
Okay. So I just wanted to make sure we have to post that. We can't, like, make a decision without it being.
I understand, but we can talk about it now.
Oh,
we?
Yeah, we can
yes.
Talk about. What we can talk about is putting it on the agenda for next week and to give us some information, general information.
Well, okay, just so I'm clear,
we can't make a decision.
We can call executive session to discuss the acquisition of land.
Right.
For any reason. Okay, that's fine. So, about the sewer rate. Would you like some information now? We're not going to make any decisions. I want to give you guys something to think about.
Sure.
And that's
so
what
we don't
and that's
come
what
into
you
this
have
blind.
To do. You just have to give us the information because it was not on our agenda, and it's under previously unanticipated. And as long as we don't make a decision or deliberate,
mm-hmm.
It's okay.
We can gather info.
Yeah, we can gather info. That's what I mean. That's what we're trying to do.
Absolutely.
Otherwise, it has to go on the agenda.
Right.
The agenda is going to close on Friday at noontime. So if there's anything else you want on the agenda from a housekeeping point of view, I will close it at noon.
Tomorrow?
Friday.
Oh, Friday. Okay.
And you will get.
Can you see that well?
Yeah. Why?
I can see it, but not that well. I just want to see if you, all right. I got the FY17 sewer rate calculations based on FY16 from Barbara. And I was going over this study that we got from, who was this from? Dave Prickett. Mm-hmm. And I was looking at the difference between 16 and 17, and there's some line items here that were really glaring to me.
Okay.
Repair, parts, and maintenance went from $20,000 to $50,000. Then engineering and consultant is $20,000, and that is not part of what's already been done. I asked Kevin about it, and he says, well, that's for future stuff. So I didn't get it. Then you go down here, and there's pump station.
Would that be, just excuse me, backing up, would that consultant be somebody that would be hired to do that, like the, I mean, if we had legal fields, if we had legal bills related to the headworks?
I have no idea. It just says engineering consultant.
Okay.
And then there's the pump station maintenance. There's $35,000 issue. There was nothing last year. And he said that's for maintenance at the end of Captain Lathrop Drive. So I asked him, you do stuff to it. How come there was nothing in it? He said he just had to rob it from other places.
That's true. We have to rob it every.
Then there's.
It's becoming a regular thing.
Infiltration and inflow mitigation, which I'm not sure how much. I mean, there's a certain requirement from the state that we have to verify this stuff. That's $50,000. There's vehicle maintenance replacement of $12,000. There's an IPP coordination of $10,000. The bottom line is the sewer budget went from $530,500 to $760,406.
Without us doing anything yet?
Yeah, that's, but that's huge. But
just in one year?
But
But most of it were those line items that I spoke about.
Okay.
So, I think what is being picked up is I think they've rounded it up, but I think there's money that we spent.
This was the amount that was approved at town meeting, that $760,000. I don't really remember, but that's okay. I'll take his word for it. Anyways, I looked at this sheet that I got from Barbara, mm-hmm. and it has the proposed budget of $760,406. And in here, if you kind of back up, we currently have a $50 service fee. We just call it a connection fee, mm-hmm. and it's split twice. So every time a bill goes out, the people pay $25. Then there's a minimum usage bill of $40 in addition to that. So the minimum bill that you can get is $65.
Right.
Per billing cycle.
So it's half a year. So it's $135
for a whole year. So, and the kicker is there's nearly, out of 881 users, almost 300 of those people pay that amount. So they're paying less than $6 a month to have sewer.
Wow.
So what I'm thinking is that this service fee should be increased to $200, being at $100 each billing cycle, and the minimum usage be $100. So every time a bill goes out, the minimum that they would pay is $200. Mm-hmm. And if you divide that out, that's still only $16 a month. And if you want to look at it another way, they talk about septic system. You build a house, a septic system is $12,000 versus this $16 a month. That's 240 years to pay for your septic system.
But every
mine
other,
was $85,000 in 1989.
But every 2 years, depending on the size of your family, you need it pumped, which is
$300. I know.
More than 100.
So, going forward.
That, we're still paying on ours.
Yeah.
Going forward, the sewer rates are going to have to go up. There's a lot of stuff that has to go on.
The only thing that bothers me, Kip, is that a lot of those minimum users are single,
You would
older.
Be surprised. I looked through there, and there were 47 of the 280-something properties owned by Deerfield Academy. And I'm not going to go into names because it's public record, but there were at least 50 other people that it's it's not an issue. I'm not saying that, you know, everybody.
What I'm saying is, how come we had talked about an institutional rate? What happened to that whole?
Well, that's another whole study. We're just looking at this coming year. Mm-hmm. So, anyways, going back to it, Barbara.
I know what you're saying about the Deerfield Academy residents, that it should be corrected if we have an institutional rate.
But that's on the homes, so it wouldn't apply to that.
No, well,
you know, it's just the schools. Their homes wouldn't apply to it.
You can't use the institutional rate based on the institution.
Oh, it's a residential house. I don't see how you could. But anyways,
I would look into that.
But that's something.
But the only thing that I worry about is your minimal users.
Well,
if you're penalizing minimal.
Well, you're not really, because, see, Barbara had come up with, to generate that money, the fees only generate $44,000.
Yeah, that's not very much.
So the rate per gallons would go up to $9.99 per thousand. If you changed it the way I suggested, the water rate would be $7.92 per thousand. So it lowers the overall rate by $2. But the minimal users, it would increase. It would go from $65 to $200. But that's still only $16 a month to have sewer. Now, you know, we have streets so with trees that are going into the sewer lines that the town has to pay to go in and repair those. There's a lot of things that we have to do to maintain that, and they're only paying $16 a month. Yeah. And the thing is that if we don't, this is going to change dramatically.
This is just the beginning.
You know, and so, you know, I think it's a good place to start, because it's not a lot of money, like I said, and it is only $16 a month. It's something to consider, and there's a lot of. A lot of the bigger users, this isn't really saving a lot, because these people are paying thousands of dollars anyways, you know.
The larger.
Yeah.
So why would this go down then?
Because instead of the service fees collecting $44,000, it would collect $176,200. And see, we only need to make up that $760,000. So the rest of the money is generated through the fees.
Yeah, so, but why isn't there a capital? I mean, there's no capital reserve.
I don't know this, but this has always been here. There's a 5% rate.
Well, that was
an additional rate for service reserve for capital expenses.
That was just random. There was not any basis for that.
Right.
Other
than so this is going to stay the same.
I felt it was very, very important to have some capital. So you only get $35,000.
This is going to stay the same, regardless of where this goes.
But why can't we increase this? Because then you can get up to this $9.
Well, the other thing is, this is going to be $15, right? I mean, didn't they start talking?
I'm sorry.
Didn't the sewer study
start talking about going up to 15?
Oh,
so
yes.
Why would
yes.
you go down to 7 and
just
then go up
just
to 15?
No.
What it is you're looking at it maybe skewed, or I'm explaining that. We need to generate $760,000. That's the budget. Okay. So how do we get there? Currently, it's proposed you leave the service fees alone and collect $44,000, and you charge $10 per thousand. That brings you up to $760,000.
What's the current rate?
The current rate is like $6.
Okay. I see what you're saying. Okay.
So this is proposed. So what I'm suggesting is that you raise the service fee and the minimum usage, and then it would go to $200, but then it would lower this. Mm-hmm. And so that's just for this 1 year.
Right.
Because next year it's all going to change.
It's a whole different story.
Okay.
But that's just this year going forward. And it's a real simple way of doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And
so we'll think about that.
Yeah.
For the
week. Think about it.
Do
I'll bring
have
this
copies
back.
Of that? Or can I make a copy of it?
Yeah.
Is the copy machine not broken?
Yeah, go make a couple copies.
Okay. Oh, that's very good.
Just so we can have something studied up on.
And
the only reason I was saying that, Kip, is because there are some people that truly are so conservative, and they need to be.
Okay, this is the other big problem, is that if you raise, I'll wait for Trevor to come back, because I don't want him to miss this.
Okay. No, that's fine. Is there anything?
But there's other issues to that.
Yes,
I want to get this in. I spoke with John O'Rourke from Something Energy, and I invited him to come to our meeting next Wednesday at 7 o'clock to talk to us about
his aggregation. Let me just write a note to Pat.
It's full, your paper. You need your clean paper.
I know. I'll just
Also, I've been in touch with a company, I think it's called Direct Energy. I asked Doug to reach out to them. Montague just recently switched their energy aggregation to them, and they're a much larger company.
So it's 10:13 at 7 o'clock?
Yes.
John O'Rourke.
And where did I lost my train of thought? Oh, and they're going to get me something.
John is supposed to come to us, our meeting, to talk about the energy.
On the 13th?
On the 13th at 7.
I won't be able to get there, but...
Oh, what time can you get there?
Well, I've got curriculum night at the Deerfield Elementary for my son's school that night. The 13th of October?
Oh.
Yep, that's 6 to probably like...
Oh, we just set their meeting at 7:45, 6:45 last week. Yeah. What time is it?
No, that's the 12th, right?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, the 12th.
The 12th, I'm sorry.
Oh, okay, so John's coming on the 12th. Oh, okay, great.
I misread your thing. I wrote the 13th. It's the 12th.
The 12th,
okay. I'll be in Boston anyway, so I wasn't even going to be here. So.
Oh,
on
the 13th?
Wait a minute. I have a state commission meeting.
No, I didn't. He's on the 19th. I'm sorry, because...
Oh, okay.
Because next weekend was not regularly scheduled. It's the 19th.
19th, okay. Sorry. Sorry.
Yeah, that's fine. Yep. And there's just to let everyone know, there's a post club spaghetti supper on that 19th at 5 o'clock for the triad, I think it is.
Oh, yeah. You know what? You should have had that as a public announcement.
Well, that's my public announcement.
Okay, 5 o'clock.
On the 19th.
Oh, I better put that in.
Triad holding a spaghetti supper at the Polish club.
Oh, man. Okay, the 19th at 5 o'clock?
Yep.
Okay. The Polish club. Senior dinner. Okay. I hope everyone got that. 5 o'clock, Polish club, senior dinner. All right, sorry.
Jumping spaghetti. Back to the sewer thing. Yes. The big reason that I, and I don't want to take the credit for this, because between Bruce St. Peter's mm-hmm. and Bruce Hunter, they gave me a lot of this information.
He's been talking about this a lot.
The big reason for changing or making this adjustment to raising the minimum and lowering the gallon rate is because you do not want to promote more conservation, because that's going to do two things. First of all, if they conserve more, our sewer plant is going to have even more problems not getting enough flow through
it. We're only about 40%.
We're going, well, not only that, but then the pipes are going to be, you know, plugging up. Also, where was I going with this? The water usage will go down, so the water department's not going to generate enough money, so the water rates are going to go up. You know, so everything's going to go up because of it.
Right.
So, you know, we have the capacity. Let the people use it. Now, if by increasing that minimum bill to $100, the people who are currently maybe only using 20,000 gallons could now use 40,000 gallons and really not pay any more for it, because
right.
that $100 is calculated, divided out by that $7.8 a gallon, you know. So they can use more water and not pay any more for it. Those the very low-end users.
I'm hoping
you know?
That people will call you after this discussion and not me.
Oh, that's all right. I mean,
we've neglected maintaining that facility and our infrastructure for so many years. I mean, it's tough to pay a bill. I know that. But at some point, we've got to address the needs that this town has with the sewer.
Well, some of the... some of the discussions that the sewer study committee is having is, you know, going to a monthly bill, but because the rates are going to be quite a bit higher, and you know, you might be looking at somewhere in the vicinity of $60, $70, $80 a month. So
that's a lot.
Yeah. Okay, so that's that.
On the up note, Jane Pierce has just been promoted. She was in charge of the...
Who's Jane Pierce?
She works for DEP. She was in charge of the 319 grants, which is your water quality grants that we've used in the past to supplement our, river bank restoration. And it's part of our match money that we've gone out and hustled for.
Okay.
And on different projects over the years. She has just been made promoted, and she's working in the Boston. Now she commutes into Boston. She's in charge of the wastewater money. So, the loans and financial stuff. So we have somebody wonderful to talk to for
great.
This kind of stuff that gets her. She's on the Orange Finance Committee.
Okay.
And I mean, I've known her over the years for a lot of different things. She's also a horse person, and so I've known her for a long time. And anyway, so I'm sad she's gone from the 319, because she was a wonderful 319 administrator for people that didn't have a lot of staff like us. And you could ask questions, and she would work with us until, you know, the cone of silence where she has to make decisions. But she would hold our hand and get stuff done, and so it was wonderful. But I think she brings that same helpful, good attitude towards
wastewater.
You know, now we need someone in wastewater, and I think we have somebody that can work with us on this, Kip. So I'll find out from her what she actually, you know, what kind of money she administers. It's wastewater loan stuff.
Okay.
So
I don't know if...
We can find out.
I don't know if tomorrow night they're going to have the same presentations that they had last Thursday in Northampton. But they had two gentlemen from the USDA, the Hadley office, and a gentleman from Boston. And that the USDA has all kinds of loans and grant programs for buying equipment, for water control, all kinds of things. And
rural development.
The guy says, he says, I'm begging you, fill out an application. He says, we do not give grants straight out. But he said, if you have a project that's going to cost $500,000, if you agree to finance with us, and we have very competitive rates, 1.5% to 3%, then we'll give you $100,000, and you can borrow the $400,000 through us. So that's the way it works. So it sounds very interesting.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, USDA rural development loans have been one of the key things for small communities, obviously. So, we've worked with them in the past.
Maybe we'll see some of that tomorrow.
Great.
Can I switch gears now?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I want to talk to you guys about...
So, the sewer rate information, I need to attach this to the...
I have it right there.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Miss Doug, don't you?
Wow. You have to just, like I said, this is a crisis opportunity here.
Yep.
Okay. All right. Now I can go on. I covered that discussion.
I want to talk to you about a lease agreement for so we can present something to the next Board of Oversight meeting. I looked into their current lease that they have with the fire district. And
so we're back to ambulance. Okay.
I know. I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. I just got to make sure I write down something.
I have to look at it three times to make sure it's in the right memory slot. Otherwise, my brain doesn't comprehend it as well. There's a couple of leases. One that was signed in 2014. And it basically charged the ambulance service $18,000 a year. It was payable in monthly installments. I don't know how it is paid. But it said that it was only for a term of 1 year, but it could be extended by mutual agreement of the parties. And if the lease was extended, it would be at 1 year terms, but it could be extended for three additional terms. Well, then I found one that was made up a year later, and everything is identical except for the dollar amount. And it talks about extending the lease, but then the dollar amount changes to $36,000. Mm-hmm. So if you're extending this lease, it doesn't say anything about the dollar amount changing. It just talks about the time changing, but the dollar amount did in fact change. So now we're paying $36,000. But everything else in the lease agreement is identical. So what I was thinking about is basically duplicating the same lease agreement, but from the town of Deerfield to the Board of Oversight, and saying, this is what the town of Deerfield is proposing. No matter how we construct that building, if it's gifted or if the town pays and builds it, this is what we want to do, and this is what we're willing to offer. The problem that I have, that I see at the Board of Oversight, is that another member town wants the Board of Oversight to pay for all of their engineering and design work, and then wants us to enter into a lease agreement that we not only pay the rent, but they want us to pay back the cost of the construction as well. And my point of view is that the other member town that wants the building in their town, they should provide everything like we're doing. It shouldn't be up to the ambulance company to pay all of their engineering fees. The ambulance business is there to run the ambulance. It's not there to get into, you know, building all of this stuff. And so I want to go prepared to outline this to them.
Okay. Why don't we put this on the agenda for next week?
Okay.
And I just don't know how I could work on this. So what I want you to do...
It's as simple as this, is that all we do is change the name at the top.
No, there is complications.
How so?
Well, just because of procurement and whatever. So what I want you to do is call Wendy and have her... This is a project, okay? This is what she's supposed to do, is to solve some of these... And she knows procurement laws.
Well, I understand that if you're going ahead with the construction, but just to offer, this is what we want to offer then, as a lease agreement. I mean,
but we have to be able to talk about it and make a decision, and we can't because this was not on the agenda.
No, I know, but I'm giving you this information.
Right.
This
and is so what I'm saying is, go forward with it. Okay. I mean, it's legitimate in my mind. So we can't make a decision, and it's not, you know. I mean, it's not in a form that we can make a decision on.
No, I...
So why don't you just work with... I mean, I think that's fine. I mean, I don't have any... I mean, we can't make a decision, but we... And I'm just saying, this is the kind of thing that Wendy... We're supposed to have Wendy work on, so just do it.
So my question would be...
Right? I mean, you don't have an issue, right?
No, it's good to learn all this stuff and find out, you know, because we want to put our best foot forward to everybody.
Right.
And be transparent. My only question was... So we come up, and this would be a sample lease agreement that we would say, because obviously we haven't gotten a building, and we don't know how all that's happening at the moment. We haven't gotten town approval and all that stuff.
Sure.
But this is what would, this is kind of what your lease would look like if you decided to go this route.
And the reason for doing this is because all of the things that we might have to do, depending on how we're building, you know, we have to, you know, hire somebody to, you know, come up with, you know, definitive plans.
Yep.
A construction cost estimate, and ultimately a proposal from a contractor. We have to have public meetings. We have to go to town meeting.
This is hugely accelerated.
Right. Yeah. But this is all the exact same stuff that Whately has to do.
Correct.
So, you know, I don't want to be put on the spot and saying, well, you know, this is just, you know, your theory or, you know, some concept that you have.
Know.
You know, it's the exact same thing that they're doing. But
they
I don't want to say I want to beat them to the punch, because that's not what I mean. I just want to be prepared. I want to have all our ducks in a row, and this is what we're willing to do. Now, with that amount of money, you know, I've looked into, you know, the cost, and I think you said that you talked with Brenda about it.
Barbara.
And so
it's $3,700 a month.
Would be one of the very few buildings this town ever built that they're actually going to get money back for, you know, not through our taxpayers.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, it's all good to talk about theory, I thought, well, then I'll just go ask Barbara, and that's why I did the 850.
Yeah.
Was because, you know,
who knows?
I just doubled it.
Yeah.
Because you said about $20,000 to add on another bay, so I said, well, okay, maybe we can put on a couple bays, and so we'll add in $50,000.
Right.
Hopefully that would be
enough. To have a ballpark of what that would be.
Yeah. So 850 is $3,700 a month, ballpark.
For a lease.
Yeah, for a lease.
Mm-hmm. I see.
I mean, we'd be covering it. Of course, the $3,700 is what we'd be paying back for the loan, so it would be a wash.
Okay.
But then we're not putting aside any money for capital.
Correct.
And capital improvements. And then you get into, expanding? Are you building this as a truly 30-year building? How much do you want to put in? Do you want to put $100 a month?
Mm-hmm.
And then you have, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I was just telling you that this is...
Ballpark stuff.
And that $3,700 a month comes in to... I mean, that's competitive with the $44.
Right.
Which is what, you know, it looked like it was going to be for The weight, you know, ball, yeah, again, they had ballpark. No numbers, they had ballpark numbers.
Well, the thing is, and this is why this is a good presentation and a good option, is because what we could put forward is $3,600 annually, period, the end. Well, with the exception, they're going to have to maintain their insight. So if whether they, you know, wash the floors or hire somebody to wash, that's something different.
Yep.
With the Whately option, they're anywhere from $5 to $8 a square foot. So their rent fee could be anywhere from $2,500 to $3,600. But then when you add on the cost of the renovations, that's going to add another $6,000 to $8,000 per month.
What?
Yes.
I thought it was going to be $4,400 a month.
No.
Really?
$6,000 to $8,000. Matter of fact, at last meeting, I think John Robleski interrupted them and said, no, Kip had made a mistake, and it came out to be $6,800. You know, that's if in fact their construction cost is the $400,000. But that doesn't include, because they don't know what is going to be the cost of the design and all that other stuff. You know, and so when you figure that in, that's where the variable comes.
Oh, my
comes.
God, I was comparing $4,400. Where did I get that from?
So if you add the rent.
I must have read that wrong.
But see, you still got to add those together. If you add the $3,000 plus the $7,000, that's $10,000 a month.
Oh, my God.
Because
then
we're
this
doing
is much,
it, because we're doing in a five-year thing. Versus if we stretched it out.
Exactly. Now, I know that the owner said, well, how is that beneficial to your taxpayers? Well, that's a decision our taxpayers will make. You know, they will say, you know, is it worth us to pay for this?
But I guess, I mean, I had in my mind, for some reason, I wrote down $4,400. And so when I got the information from Barbara of $3,700, I said, well, we might want to add a couple hundred dollars or $100 a month for maintenance.
I don't want to jump back to that, but that lease agreement that I was showing you from the fire station, do you remember signing a new one last year or just an original?
David was the fiscal agent, so I don't, I can't remember. We did vote, I'm sure we did sign it.
I have this copy of this, what do you call it, an IMU? Is that a... The agreement between the three towns?
Agreement?
An intermunicipal understanding?
Yeah.
Well, anyways, I have this copy, and I just asked Zach, you know, what was all these pink highlights? And he said that they were working to clean it up with Doug, but nothing ever changed.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know anything about it?
I remember Doug putting those forward
at one
of the meetings.
Yeah, we were, but that never went anywhere because...
I think all three towns had to...
Yeah, it has to be re-evaluated and all that.
But
so
I think it was stuff they wanted to clean up.
Yeah, we could incorporate that in some of this other stuff. I mean, that could be part of what we bring forward to the BOO together.
I mean,
together.
I don't want to...
I know, if what happened is not, it didn't just, nothing happened negatively, it just never, nobody put any more effort into it. So what we do is we just start, I mean, this is one of the things that was needed to work on.
I know you have a lot to do, but you should probably read this agreement again, too, so you get a handle on what it is.
I'll be glad. I mean, you know what I'll do? Is
I don't
I'll
have
make,
another one, so can you get one?
That's what I was going to say. Can I make a copy of this and or get... Make sure that Pat circulates a copy to us. I'm sure it's on PDF, but let me make sure that it's the same thing, okay?
And I asked Zach, and he wasn't able to answer if this is exactly how it is, you know. So I there's
this is 2013. I don't know. I will.
I remember Doug making those highlights and changes somewhere around the time of the IF the. The RFP went out.
Yeah, and
well,
also...
what I wanted to get onto.
I
asked Pat if she would show me how to get onto the computer, because I would like to look up... an RFP that we sent out?
RFP.
I'd like to get a copy of that, and I'd also like to get a copy of the responses.
Yeah.
You know, I know I read them once, but I didn't save them. They're probably in your book.
Yeah, they probably are.
What we will do is I will get a copy out to each of us, and then
we can
review it and see what we'll put it on the agenda. Our meeting is the 21st, isn't it?
Yeah.
Or the 20th or something like that. So we could put this on the agenda for the... Okay, so let's put this on the agenda. I'll get copies out, and then we need to talk about it on the 19th so that we can...
Discuss
what we want on the 20th with the Oversight Board.
And that's why I want to see...
Or just to see how this gets started again.
Right. I want to...
Because these things were generated by the Oversight Board.
Yeah, right. I think they all wanted to kind of get some changes, too.
They wanted to do it, but it never really got anywhere. Because what this is cleaning up the information.
Right. What I want to do is to know that document very well. I also want to know the RFP very well, and I want to know the responses very well. So then when I look at the Board of Oversight's,
minutes.
No, when they... decided to reject all of them. Mm-hmm. I don't want them to look at this and say, well, we rejected it for this and yours is the same. So that's why I want to make that comparison. So there's no holes in this proposal. I want it to be clean and solid, so this meets everything that you were looking for, and
mm-hmm.
Yep.
I don't like what we want to do.
Yeah. Put the best foot forward.
Yeah, this is just cleaning up information, but we didn't ever do anything with it.
How do people with big fingers operate these things?
I think you have to have good eyes, too.
No, I like it because you can blow it up. Is that a 7 o'clock that meeting?
No, it's usually 6. Last week it was 7 for our
sewer
thing.
It was 7 because Jonathan couldn't come earlier, and that's why we changed the date, too. But everyone wants 6. So it's
6 o'clock.
Okay. All right. Let me just. I don't have any stickies. I hate to copy this. Oh no. I'll remember to do it. No, Trevor, you don't have to. It was. Oh, Pat will never get my notes. I'm gonna have to go over this with her tomorrow morning before I go to Hartford. I did bring up the possibility of your building for the, so we made a tentative date for the CIP meeting. If there's no, if we don't move forward with it, then John will make a decision because we'll see if there's any capital. We were going to make a tentative decision for a meeting if there was submissions for our capital, but I also told them that potentially they could review, would be reviewing a capital request for the building. So.
All right.
I had no idea that we'd be paying so much money. How did I miss that?
I don't know.
I wrote down 4,400. That's why I said 37 sounds so, well, it sounds competitive.
It was funny because I did call John a couple weeks ago because Jonathan Edwards was talking, he was kind of going off and I was trying to really listen to what he said, and then John Robleski perked up and said something. I heard my name, but I didn't realize what he said, so I called him a few days later to ask him and he pointed that out to me.
Oh, well, that's good. Yeah. Because you missed it.
Yeah.
I was
thinking. Oh, no. I knew the dollar amount, but I didn't know that he had made that correction. Because it's just a math, you do the math,
I know, but that's a lot of money.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, how can the service talk about a business?
Well,
I mean, that's not fair.
Where the hell is this?
Okay. We're going to make a copy and distribute. Is it okay if she puts it in the box, Kip?
What's that?
I'll have her put yours back in the box.
Oh, that's fine.
And is it okay to put it in the box?
Yeah,
okay.
Sure. I'll pick it up.
Okay. All right. Is there anything else that we did not cover that you want to know about? What is going to be on the agenda next week is we'll hopefully have a draft, tentative draft of the warrant.
Okay, good.
Lisa Mead and Dick reworked his building inspector things correctly.
Okay, good.
So that's done, and that was the whole purpose of having a special town meeting. So
right.
The main thing is done.
Right.
We'll know in the next 2 weeks what we want to do, right?
Yes.
Okay. Because we have to have this done.
We have to pick a direction.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, I mean, we could wait forever, and it's just not, it's just, I know it won't fly. So we're just going to have to, you know, make a decision before we go this thing, and that's just going to be the direction we head.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And, you know.
But
it is what it is.
To do this in the way that we can get done for the 14th, we have to have
right.
open and closing of the warrant on the 19th.
Mm-hmm. Would so, it be, is it, I don't know if it's required, but do you think it would be beneficial just to have a public hearing to talk about this? Ask people what they think ahead of time?
No, what we need to do is we have to make a decision, and then we post the public hearing. We have to go to the CIPC first,
mm-hmm.
and then discuss it, and okay. then in 48 hours we can.
All right, I just think it would be good to have a meeting, not at a town meeting,
yes.
to
right.
talk about this.
Yes,
you know?
Yes,
absolutely.
And give people notice, so you know, hopefully we'll get a lot of people in. And
we're going to be meeting weekly,
yep.
and so we can dedicate a whole weekly meeting to the 10th. We could meet on the 10th or whatever the November next week is.
The November 9th?
Yes. What we can do is we can decide on the 19th what we want to do,
mm-hmm.
and then we
get
move forward, and then we'll just set up meetings.
Okay.
Yep.
But it will be extremely accelerated, and we will have to do an awful lot of outreach. And so we'll have a public hearing, but we need to be able to go to explain this to, like, the senior center. We need to
yep.
explain it, you know, have our... we need to run the tape of the public hearing. We'll get FCAT to print it, you know, to run it bunches of times on the TV so people it's accessible to people. We'll have to answer questions.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll have to prepare to get people, you know, we'll send out a robocall, one of those. We're allowed a few practice calls.
We could.
So we can do a practice call to people.
Yeah.
I mean, it's important that people
it
hear
is.
About it.
It
and,
is.
And get involved.
We can get the newspaper to write an informed article, and you know, but
I bet you
so,
write one anyways.
But we want you to meet with us and talk to us, and so we have actual, you know, interaction with you. Okay, so is there any other?
Oh, yes,
okay. Kip, you just got to get organized, man. What's going on?
That's just too much. I called the attorney for New England Natural Bakers this afternoon.
Oh, good.
And I asked them if they were going to show up.
This was successfully filed today.
Nice.
I have a copy of that, yes.
Okay.
I was applauding that at the planning board meeting. I said, yeah, thank God, this one's got numbers. Anyways, I reached out to him, and he said he had no intentions of coming tonight because it wasn't really in his wheelhouse, if you will. He said whatever, you know, the town and the owners decide to do, he's more than happy to
okay,
write up that agreement.
Can you pursue that?
Okay. So the last conversation I had, I think her name was Pam.
It is Pam.
They were going to come this evening. He said he was going to let them know with their engineering, but she once again said that she was waiting for me to get back to her.
Just give her a call.
Yeah, I will.
Because we want it's filed now.
Yeah.
Yep.
And so we should be able to transfer.
It's important to meet with whoever their engineering firm is, because it's quite clear, you know, and self-admittedly, Pam says she just doesn't know this, doesn't understand.
And
I do. I get that too. And the attorney, he's not interested in it. So it's really the engineer
you
that has to
the
come.
Water?
The water line. You know,
yeah,
and
can you then, because,
yeah,
you know, we can't have conversation.
No, I know. That's,
so
I have no problem.
So can you do that and then let Pat know?
I told the lawyer that, you know, it was only my position. I didn't want to enter
correct.
This agreement at all. I said it's foolish to tie up the town and anybody in the future with a crazy agreement like this when it can
well,
be
potentially solved. It costs us money.
Well, and potentially, yeah, but you know, down the road, it's one of those things. If you don't do it right in the beginning, it's going to come around.
And the agreement was
just that we were going to share responsibility for the buried line.
Yeah, that doesn't make sense.
It doesn't make sense.
When
no.
you can have it all in a, in
it's
a,
cheaper to do it
in
new.
The street.
Right,
yeah.
cut it
do
right
it,
off.
It'd be right in the street. Then the water department will take care of it.
Right, yeah. nobody's on it.
And
I
you
mean,
know,
it just doesn't make sense.
I don't know. Some people have better luck than I am. No matter how where you move that, if you go to expand it, it's going to be in the way.
It
again,
will
you know?
Always be in the way.
And with
it was
going
to be an issue that keeps coming up and
that's
up.
That's right. And
well,
I
put
told
new
her,
pipe.
Well, and I
why,
told her.
And
I
why
says,
did you even want to maintain old pipe?
I says because you think about this. If you now you have other people off on that, now you want to move that pipe. You just can't shut the pipe off now because there's other people. Now you have to put in a new pipe. Then you have to go get rid of the old pipe.
Well,
you
that's
know?
More expensive.
Oh yeah. And so if we're involved in that, and you know.
Yeah.
It's bad, bad.
Okay. Well, thanks for handling that.
Yeah. That's total sense. Thank you so much, because actually that potentially could save us a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, frustration
right
down
right off
the road.
The bat, it's going to save them a lot of money.
Correct.
I mean, regardless, I don't know if it's $10 a foot or $100 a
it's
foot.
A lot.
But going down the road now is only 300 feet. Moving theirs could be anywhere from 6 to 1,200 feet.
Right.
So it's
makes no sense.
It makes no sense for them to do it. And the lawyer, he agreed with me, but he says it's not his decision.
Correct.
Yep. Okay, so you'll take care of that?
I will take care of that.
Oh, wait, I got to write that down. Kip will be talking.
And since this is going to be the last time, I know I've said it, but I'm going to follow in your footsteps, Carol. I can't stress this enough. We need to get some more help in that office.
I know.
I don't even know if you could find a decent secretary if you called a temp agency, you know, and said, look, we need somebody.
We don't need a secretary. That's the thing you don't get. This is not secretarial stuff. This is actually, you have to know halfway what's going on to sort out and follow up. It's just not sitting there.
But is it just entering stuff?
No.
I mean,
no. This
there's
is
nothing
all,
in there that she does. That's just
well,
that.
She's handed that off so that okay. a large portion of it so she can process his paper. It's processing the paper.
Right, but if
and this
if,
is what normally
we,
what an executive secretary does, which our executive assistant does, the Doug job.
Right. But what, I guess what I'm getting at is what she passed off back to Brenda. Brenda's plenty busy anyways. You know, maybe this other person could come in and do that stuff and, you know, answer the phone or, you know.
It's really hard to find somebody that's. The thing is, when you're doing data entry on bills payable like that, you need to understand that you're going to make, if you make a mistake. I mean, somebody that's not connected to the material. I'm not saying that can't be done. And we, in the past, when, especially as Janet was getting less well, or less, you know, had less energy, we did have a data entry person. So maybe that would be one way to do it. But the problem is you don't, I mean, we need to get as many hours as we can for Wendy, like to scan things and make sure things are in the right place. But all this stuff, you can't hire people off the street to handle that have no clue because it, I mean, look at this. You have to follow up on all these things. And if you're, you know, a temp agency kind of person, you would not even know where in the heck to even start. And, you know, I'm in it. I don't mind coming in, but I can't do 8 hours every day.
We'll
and that
to,
would be
we'll
supervising.
We'll need to start somebody at some point soon
yeah.
so that they can learn how to do all that stuff or hire somebody that does.
Well,
so we got to
I mean, and
that.
That's why one of the, you know, this is where this came from.
Mm-hmm. Are there college are there college classes that kids learn municipal government? Could you reach out to the university to see if there's, you know, I mean.
We'll find out.
I know.
We'll find out.
Wendy is addressing, Wendy and I have this discussion, and we will come up with some kind of proposal by next week, hopefully.
Okay.
Or you can talk with her individually.
Yep.
She will be here next week.
Yep.
But not until then.
Well, you can call her.
Yeah, I'm gonna.
She's available by phone.
Okay.
She is not physically able to get here.
Right. Okay.
But that doesn't mean that she's not handling stuff. I mean, she's doing stuff right now. I mean, we've got a project list.
That the warrant article for the school
Yes, that's one of the things she's doing.
So I talked to Pat.
Yes.
And she had, Patty Kavanaugh, and she sent me over some language today, so I gave it to Wendy
okay.
for that warrant article, but I don't think Wendy thought it wasn't what was needed, but so I think in the end we should just kind of take what they gave us and whatever we have to adjust legally to have that in there. We have the figure, and I think we could just make it up.
But see, that's something like that. Wendy's handling. She'll negotiate with the lawyer, so
correct.
We don't spend, you know, $500 on a school article.
Right.
You know, it's just there is some question.
Yep.
Is our language going to mesh with four towns?
Correct.
Is the language correct?
Yep. So I've got a copy of that, and I'll get it to Pat tomorrow.
Yeah.
Our pack.
Okay.
And then she can come to work.
Is the number that 17,000, is that?
That's accurate.
That's accurate.
That's
okay.
accurate.
That's
ours.
What we need
what
to.
That's what was left in there that they just need to repurpose for the move.
Okay. That's the main thing.
Yep.
But all four towns have got to.
Approve it.
Approve of the 17,000 in the same way.
Correct.
That the money actually moves. And
correct.
So. But that's something Wendy can follow up on.
Yeah.
And that, I mean, that's a worthwhile thing.
I have a quick question. On the offices that are in Waitley and Christian Lane, does the school department own that building?
Yes.
Or does the town of Waitley rent it to them?
No, they own the building.
They bought
own the building. Now, I had heard something
Over many protests, but...
Okay, but...
It happened.
Does it include a certain... number of acres or just a very small
I think it's
park.
Just right around or the land
it's very
under the
small.
Building.
It's very
and then
small footprint.
Waitley owns like the
ball,
field out
ball
there.
Field. Okay, yeah.
And then I think Frontier and Deerfield, Frontier had the first right of refusal on that property and Waitley had the first right of refusal on that building.
Okay.
That's what I've heard, but I'm not positive.
I don't remember.
So Frontier has a first right of refusal on the field, but
on
not
the
town of Deerfield.
Correct.
Okay.
I think it's, yeah, because right. I think it's Frontier that owns it.
Yeah.
I'm just curious.
Oh, yeah. It's Frontier District.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was Union 38
that
we put money into every year for renovations.
Is that yours or mine? No, it's yours. All right. I'm good.
Okay. Is there anything else? Okay. I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Okay.
Second. I'm sorry.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.